Somebody didn't learn
to break every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus.
Come and lift up those hands and declare.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power. There is power.
Somebody declare the power of the living God.
There is power in the name of Jesus. Yes.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Yeah. In the name of Jesus. To break every chain. Yeah.
Break every chain.
Break every chain.
There's an army rising up. the name of the Lord for his grace, and we bless the name of the Lord for his goodness, and for this day that the Lord has favored us and given us another opportunity and a privilege to come online and to be able to share with you. In such times when a lot is happening globally, in such times when questions are many in every sphere of people's lives, in times like this, when there's a lot of warmth and coldness, not only in the world, but also in the body of Christ, we need to get a word. We need to be ignited in the presence of the Lord. We don't just need to get a word, but we need to get a rhema word. And I believe with all my heart that as I share this word, this message today, I'm going to be a little bit slower than ever. But as I share this message, I trust and believe that the Spirit of God and the hand of God is going to lift you. There's going to be a unique anointing that is going to touch and transform your life. There's going to be a victory that God is going to allow to flow through your life in Jesus' name. And from whatever point you're watching us from, there are people that are watching us here in Africa, in Uganda, East Africa, and there are people that are following us from the Western world. All of you are welcome on the platform. Those of you that are viewing us for the first time, and those of you that are regular, that follow us every day, there are people that follow us, tune in every day from Trinidad and Tobago, and now I'm aware that your time zones are different. Even those in America, while we are preaching in the afternoon, they are still crossing into the morning of the new day. And there are also other people in the Asian side that are in the evening of their lives. But we praise and thank the Lord so much. Even for the people that revisit this broadcast, we thank the Lord so much for you. And also for the Holy Spirit that has enabled us to be able to minister every day, to talk to people, the messages he has given us, the grace he has granted us, the spirit and the victory that God has allowed to come through us, to touch, to reach into people's lives. Now today, I want you to, as I'm preaching, be free also to interact. Be free also to send in a scripture of encouragement. Be free to send in your testimonies. I believe that the season that we've been in, there are many things that God has done. Has the Spirit of God lifted you? Has the Spirit of God energized you? Has the Word of God revived you, restored you? Were you a backslider? Were you fallen? Did God restore you and revive your life? Did something happen to you? Please feel free to and comfortable to text to us. Just text as I'm preaching. Send in your testimony. Number two, send in an encouragement to somebody that is broken as I preach. Let it be an open mic. Let it be an open mic today. As we share, throw in your testimony. As we share, throw in your scriptures. As we share, encourage others on the line. I love and I want to say I love you. Today I'm going to be a little bit slower, but I'll catch up as we go. Now we are going in the book of Exodus, chapter 17. I was led by the Spirit of God to deal or to talk about it, to bring this message to your hearing. And I believe that as we share and as we go together, page by page, there are certain things you're going to discover that have been necessary. There have been necessities that we had avoided. You know, we had avoided them, but they were very important in our journey and in our walk with God. Ladies and gentlemen, greatness is a result of a lot of work. For you to be great, it doesn't just come overnight. God allows us to be processed through storms, through situations, and he allows us to be processed by allowing other leaders, allowing other people that are superior and above us to be able to mentor us. Sometimes God subjects us under mentors that are not very friendly. Just like Elijah and Elisha, a man that is always calling down fire and burning people, just like Saul and David. But of course, when God puts you under leadership, the leadership may not look pleasant to you, but God, the Bible says in Jeremiah, and I will appoint shepherds after my own heart. Why? God will choose a leader that is entirely connected to your destiny, and two, that God has given everything that it takes to make you what he wants you to be. There's a challenge in the dispensation we are leading and the frenzy we are in, where people choose their own leaders. And it is important, it is good also for people to choose who they sit under. But when you're under a person that God has ordained to be your leader, he may not be friendly when he's dealing with you. He may not be friendly when he's training you. But ultimately, at the end of the journey, when you cross the tunnel, then you realize that was the best hand. Those were the best hands that you had to go through. I'm a product of a lot of pain and happenings that came through to my life in the past. But when I look back at what I went through, and the people that didn't go through it, I realized that I'm miles away from them. Why? Because while I was going through the squeezings and the beatings and the scourgings and the bickerings, to them they were having a wonderful party. But I was trained, I was prepared for the future that I was going to. Why? Because God had to train me in yesterday to be able to stand the storms of now. So it is important also that God allows you to grow and to be processed in with his own way, that at the end of the day, ultimately, finally, you shall become the finished product of your life. So there are certain things that we have neglected as the body of Christ and as the children of God. There are things that we have not given audience to. There are things that we've turned a deaf ear to and a blind eye to. There are certain things also that we have circumvented. We have avoided them. We have to go through them, but we want to go above them, besides them, or below them. But God has designed the temperature that we have to go through, that when we go through that particular kind of temperature, there is something that it grooms on the inside of us. Ladies and gentlemen, God never wastes his fires. Every temperature, every scorch of fire is designed to do something. Every scorch and every temperature that you go through is designed to accomplish a certain thing in your life. And ladies and gentlemen, with understanding that, I want us to know that God on your side and God leading you to places and to areas of victory, there are certain things that God must ordain. Like for Christ to be the King of Kings, for Christ to be the King of Kings, to reach into that dimension of grace, that dimension of greatness, there are certain things that were written and they were tailored for him. Other men of God and prophets of old could not sustain the power or the ability to go through them. But because Christ was the candidate, that was the measure of trial and test that was assigned to his garment, assigned to his calling. So most of us, when we face certain things, we are quick to relinquish, we throw in tantrums, we throw in the towel, we begin to say, God must not be in this, because if God was in this, then everything would be perfect. Ladies and gentlemen, there is a possibility that Jesus can be in the boat and the storm can hit the boat and water begins to enter. There is a possibility that you can be on the journey, the right journey to destiny, and the enemy might be confronting and bombarding you. But when God is working behind the wiles of the enemy, how could you ever believe that the story of Joseph, a young boy that God has thrown the vision of the future into his system, how could you ever believe that a young boy like Joseph, going through everything, from the hatred of the brothers to the fathers loved him and given him a coat of many colors, then the brothers are beginning to hate him, from the hatred of the brothers, you know, God, the father has selected him, the brothers are beginning to hate him. But who could ever know that with all that was happening, who could ever believe that Joseph still had a destiny in spite of what was happening? Why? Because he chooses the way he takes us. He chooses the way of our training. He determines the way of our making and the path of our making. Sometimes there are people that are made, and the best way they are supposed to be made is they are made in pain. Now, the Bible says we are God's battle axe, I'm beginning. And when the Bible says we are God's battle axe, now let us put that in picture. For an axe to be made, it's not an axe. It's a piece of iron, but it has to be subject to a certain temperature. Because God says, you are my battle axe, with you I will cut and I will uproot, and with you I'll break asunder. Now that means you can't be an axe until you've been made. He has to subject you to a certain temperature of fire, a degree of fire that has to burn you until you are ready for the beating. Now after the burning, there is a beating. Now when you look at this iron, when it's going through this process, subject to the process, it may seem as if it's going through torture. But it's not torture, but it's a making in process. There are many of you that are following right now, and what is happening right now is not a punishment from God, but a preparation by God. Ladies and gentlemen, sometimes we languish and cry as if we are going through a moment of a God-forsaken world. We look like we are God-forsaken. Yes, when Christ was at the cross, he begins to say, Elohim, Elohim, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now, he said that my Father and I are one. Now, when he says my Father and I are one, we expect that they are always in union. He's the second person in the Trinity. But there are moments where God mutes his presence in our lives, and he wants us to go through certain things. He does not change the process because he does not want to change the product. Can I say it again? He does not change the process because he knows the finished product and how it will be after it is subject to this kind of process. In agriculture, there are plants that grow in acidic soils, and there are others that grow in alkaline soils. Now, those in acidic soils and the alkaline soils are different. There are Christians that cannot grow until they are loved and pampered, and there are Christians that cannot grow until they are hated and bickered. Now, it depends on the maker. Because he designs us, because he programs us for what we are supposed to do. Now, because he has in mind and in picture what we are supposed to do and what we are supposed to be, because he knows what we are made for, he determines what we are made of. Can I say it again? Because he knows what we are made for, then he determines what we are made of. He determines that these ones are going to be made like this. People like Jonathan, those ones did not have to go through the pain of David. You see, people like John the Revelator, in the beginning, he was always in the bosom of Christ. But for him to reach the perfection of the glory, there was supposed to be a pressure attached. The Bible says, and they cooked him. Bible books talk about him being roasted in boiling oil. Why? Because there is a measure of affliction that is responsible for the making of greatness. There is a measure of affliction that is responsible for the making of greatness. There is a measure of affliction that is responsible for the making of greatness. There is a measure of affliction. There is a dimension of affliction that we go through when God is making us. The making of a leader, the making of an entrepreneur, the making of a mother, the making of a father, the making of a shepherd, the making of a prophet, the making of an apostle. There has to be procedures and processes. So as God is processing us sometimes, there are people that have fallen off, that are run off. Now, this is a table. I'm just giving you some advice. This is a table. You know, this is a podium. It's a poop. It's a podium. But in the beginning, it's not a podium. In the beginning, it's a tree that is in the forest. Now, for it to be set apart, to be secluded, to be distinct from all else, the chooser has to see it and view it and visualize it and know that this is the caliber or the type of tree that is going to make this. Now, as the tree is being felled or cut from the forest, it does not understand that its finished product is going to make it more desirable than where it is. So when the chooser chooses the type of tree to cut and to make the podium, the process is long. After cutting it out, they have to put it under the sunshine, the scorching sunshine, exposed. The sun has to you know, the scorch of the sun has to dry it. And after a season, they have to bring chisels. And after they are chiseling, there is a lot of noise and sound. Sometimes God is chiseling us by taking some people from us. Sometimes he's chiseling us by squeezing a certain character out of us. Sometimes he's chiseling us by breaking certain habits in our lives. Sometimes he's chiseling us by disconnecting us from the people we love most, because we love them for what they are to us now, but they could be destructive for what he has for us tomorrow. So what he does, he cuts them away from us. He cuts them. He cuts them from us. He cuts them from us. As he's cutting them, we are crying. We are fighting. We are crying. Why? Because we don't know that the chiseling is making us perfect. Every process is painful, but it's working towards perfection. Every process is painful, but after the process, there's a progress. Oh, Shelehetai. I wish I knew this years ago. There are certain things that God has subjected us to. They are painful, but they are birthing something out of us. After that, they will get a very merciless hammer. A very merciless hammer. And then they will get nails. And then they will begin to pound and to put nails in. Now, the table does not know. God told Moses, prepare the table of showbread. Go cut the tree, this particular type of tree, and prepare me a table of showbread. Now, the bread is going to be, the bread of the presence is going to be on the table. But the table does not know that God has selected it. There are calibers of people that God has seen your character through your past and traced it through the historicity of your life, that only your caliber can do a certain work. Peter could not be the apostle of the New Testament. Yes, he was chosen as the Pope, as the leader of the church. When Jesus was departing, he says, upon this rock shall I build the church. He was the leader of the disciples. But it had to take a caliber of a person like Paul, with a background of such a lifestyle. Only that one could put us together and teach us the treaties of the gospel and the things that we need to understand. When you study the books of the disciples, Mark, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, then 1 Peter and 2 Peter, you know, they talk mainly about the historicity of Jesus. They talk about the geographical places and the events that occurred. But when Paul comes on the scene of the gospel, he brings the mind. He attaches us. He begins to talk to us, and he causes paradigms to shift. He talks about the gifts. He talks about the church. He talks about eternity. You see, we needed a Paul in the equation of the Bible. But remember, when Paul is coming, God has to find him. But when Paul came, every season of his life, there was a storm, there was a hurricane, there were pains. He was subject to things that were destructive. They would stone him, but the next day he would go back and preach. Why? Because the engine in him had been wired for such a time, for such a style. They would stone him, they would scourge him, and he would go the next day. Why? Because God had implanted in him the unquenchable, unebbable fire, the zeal for the things of God. He talks about the thorn in the flesh. He ascends to the heavens, third heavens, but he returns, and there was given to him a thorn in the flesh. The thorn is in the flesh, but he's managing with the thorn in the flesh. The thorn is there, but he has to manage. He's managing with the thorn in the flesh. He's managing with the thorn in the flesh. He manages with it. He has the power to wait. He's managing with the thorn in the flesh. Everything that the enemy is doing, he's trying to push him, but he's managing. He's managing with the pain. He's managing with the rejection. He's managing with the confusion. He's managing with the frustration. He's managing with everything that they are doing. Why? The thorn is there. But God has seen ability. Not every disciple could manage the thorn. But Paul, when God has designed him, he gives him the ability to manage with the thorn. He's preaching life, but the devil is buffeting his body. He's preaching deliverance, raising the dead, but there's a thorn in the flesh. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking to a generation. I'm talking to personalities that cannot deny their destiny. Number one, God has given you a sneak peek. He has given you a sneak peek about what is about to happen. Some of you, God has shown you. I'm talking to preachers. God has showed you the wide view of the spectrum. He has shown you how big and vast your ministry is going to be. He has shown you how great the grace of God is going to operate in your life. Dimensions of anointing, dimensions of superiority. God is going to give you the tongue of the elite, the language of the educated. God is going to write you on the hearts of people. He's going to write your name indelibly on the hearts of men. But ladies and gentlemen, with all that in the process, with all that in the future, there is a now that God has given you, that you should do a work in yourself, that you should study and be approved, a good workman who have you to divide the word of truth. God has prepared you that you should be able to stand. Why? Because God has to train us. Number one, he trains us. And after training us, he tries us. And after trying us, he proves us. You see, he trains us to try us. And after trying us, he approves us. And when he approves us, then he commissions us. Now, most of you are going through the trainings. He's giving you every scripture. He's giving you, nourishing your soul with every song of worship, taking you to different atmospheres, sitting under men and women of God that carry weights of grace, that can deliver you from sin, that can deliver you from corruption, that can deliver you from false doctrines. And finally and ultimately, he's going to usher you into that dimension. And when you reach there, you're not safe yet. Because when you reach there, the more you're there, the more attacks. The enemy will attack you on your way to destiny, but he will fight you when you arrive. It is harder to get to destiny, but it is twice, thrice, quadrupleted times harder to maintain. To climb the mountain is easy, but to come down is easy. To climb the mountain is hard, but to come down is very easy. There are things you need to be steadfast. I'm talking to you. You need to be steadfast. It is easy to get a fiancé. It is easy even to cross and have a ring on you. But it takes 3 times or 7 times more energy to maintain your marriage. It takes everything easy. Sometimes we get it easy, but maintaining is very hard. You could want a good car and somebody can bless you with it. You can buy it. But the maintenance of that car, it will cost you more than an arm and a leg. There are certain things, we desire them, but we don't have the capacity yet to maintain them. So because we cannot maintain them, God cannot waste them. Because anything you cannot maintain will be wasted when you have it. So ladies and gentlemen, I began by giving you these insights as I'm going into the scripture of the book of Exodus chapter 17. I'm giving you this insight so you can prepare yourself. God did not waste his promises towards you. He did not waste his promises towards you. Everything that emanated from the mouth of God will surely come to pass. Everything that the Lord has written upon your system, that you are thrown in the spiritual realm and has allowed you to view it, it is already there in the eternal realm. Now your maturity and your preparedness will bring it to pass according to seasons and times. When you are mature in God and when you're ready for it, then God will allow it to come to you. Ladies and gentlemen, to those of you that are parents, you could have inheritance, and probably you have a young man, a young boy who is 13, 14, 15, could even be 20. But their lifestyle, you want to give them their legacy, like the prodigal son. They have a lifestyle. They have not yet outgrown pride. They have not yet outgrown a braggish life, a flamboyant life. So, you know, if I expose them to these condominiums, if I expose them to the monies in the bank, within 3 years, they will have destroyed themselves. They don't know the money is there, but you know it. They are close to you. They are close to the promiser. They are close to the will for you to have them. But every time you look at them and look on the inside of their hearts and you see something cropping up that can be destructive, or it will grow bigger when they see this treasure, you hide it from them. Some of us, we are around the mountain. Like Abraham is going to the mountain, we are around the mountain. We feel like it's our season. But because the dimension of our preparedness and the level of our understanding does not tally with what God wants to bring, we are closer to it, but never with it. That's why many people tell me, Pastor, I'm always almost there, but I'm never there. I'm always almost getting it, but I lose it by a whisker. Yes, because our preparedness and the dimension of our readiness cannot tally with what God is bringing. As long as a hair is a child, the inheritance will stay in the hands of the tutor. Maturity is a must happen. For you to deem yourself mature, maturity is known by responsibility. How you manage affairs of life. How responsible are you to yourself? There are many of us, no matter how we scream, yell, holler, and cry in the presence of God, we are not yet ready for what God has for us. He has shown you the picture, but he has to allow you to go through the process, because the product he wants to give you requires a dimension and a version of you that has outgrown certain things. Begin to grow now. Grow now, that the future may not go far from you. The more you grow in the things of God, the more you grow in management of people. There are people that love to be great, but their character and temperament has not been trimmed and tailored to manage people. You are quick to attack people. You are quick to confront. You know, there are certain things you can't even bury in your soul. Anything you hear, you want to be confrontational, and that is good. But sometimes, if you can't manage the 10, you can't manage the 100. If you can't manage 100, you can't manage 1,000. There is something you have to allow God to trim in your temperament. Allow somebody stronger. Allow somebody wiser to talk in your spirit, to begin to put you right. There are people that I'm talking to right now, you don't submit under anybody. There's nobody that you call a father. And that's yes. There are people who say, I know I'm my own leader. Yes. But until you have a hand of authority that can correct you without fear, there are certain errors we are going to make, and our children will grow in error, and they'll be deleting, correcting. But I'm talking to you right now that God will locate a father, that God will send. You know, Moses is anointed, very anointed. But if he doesn't listen to Jethro the Midianite, he's going to die young. He's doing everything by himself. Now he's anointed, he hears the voice of God, he talks to God because he's on the purpose of God. But he requires a Jethro of Midian to tell him, Moses, you're going to die. You need to appoint leaders. We need advisors. We are anointed. They may not be having the monies we have. They may not even have the fame and the influence we have. But they can talk our spirits into life. They are like life coaches. They have walked in life. Some of them are even moving on clutches. They survived storms and tempests. But they have a word that can take you to the next level. Three, when we get to that point, then we are closer. Some of us are closer to the mountain. We are closer to the breakthrough. We dream it every day. We smell it every day. We feel like, whoa, we touch it every day. But between it spiritually and its materializing and matriculating in the physical realm, there are certain levels. There are areas that certain things don't land. No matter how good the grass is, eagles don't stay on the grass. Eagles, they stay on high trees and on high mountains. Some of you, the spirit you desire, the anointing and the grace you desire, you need to have, is a higher dimension of grace. It requires your character trimming. It requires the trimming of your temperament, how you manage people, how you manage societies. There are people that are too weak when they come into the light. And there are people that are too frustrated because the light, being able to stand in the light alone, the tension of having to meet thousands of people, hundreds of people, the tension of having to talk to them and them talk back to you. Because sometimes God will allow the criticisms of people, but he wants to see your temperament. You talk to people and they talk back to you. Sometimes we raise people who stab us and we still have to feed them the word of God. We raise people that are betraying us, but we still have to feed them with the word of God. Now, if you're fighting whoever is doing something wrong, then you're killing the bigger picture. I don't know why I've gone this direction. There is a bigger picture in your life. Some of you are too beautiful and too aged. It is impossible for you not to be married. But the problem is, and the question is, that you are ready. Physically, the body is ready, but genuinely, you're not ready. Some people are just tired of living alone and tired of responsibility. And I would counsel you not to get married just to run away from your bills. Because when you go to get married simply because you're tired of the bills, or number two, when you go to get married simply because you are tired of certain things around you, then it's going to cause a question. Why? Because after you've exhausted him and after he has exhausted you, now you are living with the real man after you have exhausted one another. Finally and ultimately, let my Holy Spirit help me. Finally and ultimately, after you have exhausted everything, the reality will come. You know why? You are running to him because of the money he has. You are running to him because of the fame he has. But after the fame and the money, and after he has been with you for a year, for 6 months, now reality kicks in. You are running not because you are ready for responsibility, but you are running because you are tired of the routine of life. You need to allow your mind to absorb certain things. To young ladies, it involves sitting with mothers and elderly women. They have to train you. They have to talk to you how to handle a man, how to handle a woman. And it is written, I had it in a statistical book, that most of the times, young men that have grown in families without a father, it is harder for them to be husbands and to father their children. And on the contrary, women that have only been groomed by single mothers, sometimes they have not seen a male voice. They have not seen a mother submit. Now, because of them, some of them have become hustlers. They are go-getters. They take it. They don't take no for an answer. Now, anybody that is a hustler cannot be easy to bend low to subjugate their rank to a man. And that is why many of the people that are celebrated or celebrities, it is harder for them to remain married. Why? Because there is something in them. There is something in them that is lacking. I want to pray for you. Now I'm going vast and I'm going to read the scripture. I want to pray for you that God will help you not to avoid the process. I've seen many young men, even from the church that I pastor. They dream they are going to nations. They know they are going to be great men, but they never study a Bible. They believe that scriptures are going to come by divine osmosis because they can shout in prayer. They know they have it. No way. Prayer is not everything. There are certain things. Prayer contributes 40%. But the others, the character trimming, the attitude adjustment, then of course, temperaments, the trimming of temperaments, then other things. You know, there are many things that constitute and contribute to greatness. Ladies and gentlemen, I talk to you from wherever you're watching from. There are certain things that you must not miss this season. This is the year that the Lord has spoken to you. In spite of the 6 months that are, 3-4 months that have really laid many people down, ladies and gentlemen, because it is marvelous and amazing before us, does not mean it's amazing before God. He saw COVID-19, he measured it and weighed it, and he knew that while others will be going down, there will be remnants and survivors. He saw the plague and the season. He marked those days of the calendar. Some prophets foresaw it. And they declared it. Maybe people didn't give audience. But amidst all that, even in the times when the churches are not gathering, there must be something reserved. There must be extra oil. The woman, the Shunammite woman, who had, the husband died. She was a widow. And then the creditors come. They want to take the children because there's no money. There's nothing they can sell to get their money. What happened? When the creditor came, Mashandi Kamaya, the woman runs to Elisha with an expectation that Elisha was going to give her some money. She ran to Elisha, and Elisha said, "What do you have in your house?" Meaning the miracle of your desire should be connected with something that is already with you. It has to be in base and it has to be around you. Most of the people today, Christians, they want everything to come from God. They don't want their involvement in the issue. They don't want their involvement in the equation. I preach on television, and many times people just send a text, "Pastor, pray that my husband comes home. Pray that my boyfriend will call me." Now, what are you doing? Before I pray, what caused him not to call you? What broke the rhythm? Some things are characters. Others are personalities. Others, we are too stiff to be humble. We are too strong to be humble. And sometimes many people wish to win arguments but lose relationships. You can win an argument and lose your marriage. You can win a fight and lose your spouse. Sometimes you have to learn to bend low. There are certain failures that are necessary. You have to fail to remain a champion. That was an advice. Listen to me. Ladies and gentlemen, the woman comes to Elisha and says, "What do you have?" She says, "I have nothing but a cruse of oil." The creditor could tamper with the children, but not the cruse of oil. There has got to be a reserved oil, like the 10 virgin girls. The Bible says, and 5 went. They had oil in the lamp, but they did not have extra oil. In the season of the lockdown, there are many Christians that are in the pits, in the waterless pits right now. They don't feel any touch of the Holy Spirit. They no longer feel any sensitivity. Even in the dreamland, the enemy has covered them with a nefas of dark powers. They sleep and they dream cows, dogs, rats, snakes pursuing them. Why? Because their connection spiritually has been cut. They don't have extra oil. The woman says the creditor has come, but I only have an oil. And Elisha said, "Yes, that is good. Because of the oil, the enemy can touch anything but the oil. Give me oil in my lamp. Keep it burning. Give me oil in my lamp, I pray. Give me oil in my lamp. Keep it burning. Keep it burning to the end of days. You need the oil. Let them take everything minus the oil. Let them break everything but minus your connection to your Elisha." Every leader has people that are subject to them that are beneficiaries of anointing. This anointing was given to us by God, but it is not for us, it is for people. Now, the anointing you connect with becomes the anointing that will begin to move in the equation of your problems. They take everything, but there is a cruse of oil. My question, do you have that cruse in you? Do you have scriptures in your system? Do you have a word in your calamity? Do you have a candle in your dark night? Do you remember a promise? I love the 4 faces that the Bible talks about in Ezekiel and of course in Revelation. Ezekiel, the Bible talks about the 4 faces. Ezekiel talks about the face of a cow, the face of a cow and ox, the face of a lion, the face of an eagle, and the face of a man. Now, when I extrapolate the face of a cow, there are 3 characters that a cow has. When you look at an ox, they attach it to a yoke and it works in a garden. Jesus says, "Take my yoke upon you, for it is humble and light." You need to learn to carry the yoke of God. Now, there are 2 yokes. There's what they call the baros and the froshon. One is the yoke that the enemy ties to us to bind us. The other is the yoke that God puts upon us to keep us. You get what I'm saying? Now, the yoke, the ox has a yoke. 2, when the ox or the cow is moving, it does not waver from its path. Whether a train is coming, whether cars are coming. I normally visit Botswana. And as we are driving from Haboroni to Francistown, it's a very long place, it's a long space, it's 500 kilometers. Now listen to me, not 500 kgs, but 500 kilometers. Sorry, a slip of tongue. But always when you're driving in the night, there are cows crossing. They don't mind whether it's a huge car or a small car. They cross when they want. You need to have a resolve that when you begin on your purpose, nothing can talk you out of your purpose. Nothing can divert your focus. When you begin on a project, whether things are contrary, you have to have a disaster preparedness in your system. You must be able to stand when things are not working. When your husband falls sick and everybody has run away, you have to stay there. Lay hands on him. Trust God. Take him to the hospital. When your wife is funny, you have to have the capacity, the ability to stay there. When your children are not becoming what you want them to be, maintain. Stay in the fight. Stay in the fight. Why? Because you must have the persistence. You must have the consistency. You must have the insistence. Remember, persistence wears down resistance. I wish I would talk to you. Persistence wears down resistance. And remember, the more valuable you are, the more vulnerable you are. The third thing, the cow, when it eats food by day, it regurgitates in the night. You need to have that regurgitative effect. You have to bring back the promises of God. You have to remember the visitations. Run to the place where God visited you. Run to the moment where God touched you. And as you rehearse those moments, the same anointing, because anointing is eternal, it crosses between eternity and time. The anointing will revamp and revive in your spirit. In this COVID-19 season, you need to stand. There are destinies waiting for you. God, some of you are tables of showbread. You've been in the carpentry. They are fixing legs. They are painting you. Don't run away. There is a great woman in the making. There is a great man in the making. There is a great businessman in the making. There is a great entrepreneur in the making. There are apostles in the making. There are prophets in the making. There are billionaires in the making. Stay in the carpentry. Let God teach you to stand still, and know that is God. Let Him teach you to stand against the odds of life. Let God teach you to stand when everything is contrary. Let God teach you to stand. He's planting you. He's establishing you. There's a wave of grace. There are dimensions of victory that God is about to do. And I tell you that after this message, you need to wear your garment spiritually. Put your cloak on, put your garment on, and begin to pursue. Have a precision. You have the oil. You have the oil. There's an oil. You don't have money, but the fire burns in your heart. I love what Jeremiah says in 20 verses 11. He says, even if I refuse to make mention of his name, his word is like a fire shut up in my bones. And then in my heart, and I'm weary with forbearing. There has to be a remaining. There has to be a fire. There has to be an extra oil. Now I tap on the extra oil. Elisha tells the woman, borrow empty vessels and begin to unfill. The miracle happens by connection. The miracle happens by preservation, preserving the oil, connection to Elisha. And three, by obedience. She begins to unfill in other vessels. Mashande kemaya. As I'm talking, there are chains breaking. As I'm talking, there are maladies going. As I'm talking, there are miracles happening. Yes, my sister, there's a miracle for you. There's a victory for you. There are chains breaking. There are answers granted. I feel the chains of the enemy. They are rendered powerless. The enemy had pulverized you, pounding you, but God has given you a chance. Now you're better than yesterday. Now you're stronger than yesterday. Now you're fairer than yesterday. And you're closer to your finish line. You're closer to the victory that God has in store for your life. Here's an extra oil as I close. I was going to Exodus 17. I have to give you this scripture in just 7-10 minutes. Exodus 17 from verses 10. And then I'll close. Thank you, Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God is with us. Bring others online. Encourage them to be part of this. Exodus chapter 17. Listen to what the Bible says. From verses 8. The Bible says, then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. This is an instruction the Lord has instructed me to give you. Then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men and go out fight with Amalek tomorrow, and I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hands. Now listen to the dimension. Listen to how they are working this thing. I have 10 minutes to go. Listen to me. Number one, this battle has confronted them. Amalek chooses to attack Israel. But it's not Israel against Amalek. It's Amalek against Israel. Time and again, we are faced with confrontations. There are people that confront us in our places of work. There are people that confront us even in the purpose as we are driving the purpose of God in our lives. There are people that confront us in our marriages. There are people that confront us, and there are situations and circumstances that confront us. A sickness confronts you. A storm from nowhere confronts you. There's a woman watching, and there's a nightmare. There are things that are happening in your house. And you're in the Western world, there are things that are happening. You literally hear people talking in your house at night. and they are not your family. You hear movements in your house, but God is sending a flame of fire. The angel of God is cutting that away from you. He's breaking it and destroying it in the name of whatever was a horror in your house is going right now in the name of Jesus. Now listen to me. Amalek confronts Israel, and the Bible says, verse 10, So Joshua did as Moses had told him, said to him, and he fought with Amalek and Moses and Aaron, and how went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass when Moses held up his hands that Israel prevailed, and when he let down his hands, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, my God, and they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon, and Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands, the one on one side and the other on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. I'm sharing briefly as I close the power of connection and the power of united hands. I spoke about the Shunammite and Elisha. Ladies and gentlemen, there are battles that we have failed, especially in this season, because the hands of saints have had, there's a loose connection between the Moses on the mountain and the saints in the valley. Joshua is a fighter, but there's a connection between the fighting of Joshua and the raising of hands of Moses. Moses is not fighting physically, but spiritually. His hands, not only but the rod. This was the same rod that performed miracles from day number one of his encounter at the burning bush in the book of Exodus chapter 3. God tells him, what do you have? He says, nothing but a rod. He says, drop it. And it became a serpent. And the Bible says, as it was going, Moses was afraid. God told him, touch it by the tail. And when he touched it by the tail, the Bible says it became a rod. Why? He's acquainting him with the methodology and the system of Egypt. Because he has been there. Now God is sending him because the terror in Egypt, the dominance or the controlling power in Egypt was in a snake. It was a serpent. That's why upon every Pharaoh's crown, there's a symbol of a python, a cobra, a snake. Now, when he goes to Egypt, by the rod, he throws it, it becomes a snake. The magicians do the same according to their magical arts. Now the Bible says, thank you, Holy Spirit. The Bible says somebody's knee has just been healed. Thank you, Jesus. And the Bible says, thank you, Holy Spirit. The Bible says, and he dropped it, it became a rod. They did the same and they swallowed them. The snake of Moses swallowed their snakes. And of course, these other nine plagues. The tenth was the plague of the lamb. Smear the blood upon the doorpost. That wasn't the rod, but the lamb. Then as they are crossing, the rod is stretched on the waters. It is Moses doing the miraculous, and the Israelites are enjoying as benefits. But when they get to the book of Exodus again, as they are crossing, when Amalek attacks them, it's not just the rod. But the rod has to be a symbol of testimony before God. Moses is raising it. You've always healed us and delivered us by you, this rod. Now, what more should we do? The more the hands are high, there's a connection when your pastor's hands are lifted, when your bishop's hands are lifted, when your father's hands are lifted. Ladies and gentlemen, there are certain victories that will be automatic. What is the connection? How comes that when the hands are down, the Amalekites begin to kill Israel. Why? Because there's a connection between leadership and the people. Leadership and followership. Many of you that are watching right now, the reason why you're making losses, the reason why your jobs are not stable, is because you only got to get the word, but you're never putting your hands on the hands of the people that are leading you. The Lord instructed me to talk to the online church that through the COVID-19, many people have lost a lot. And because the churches were closed, people, believers, relegated their responsibilities. They are no longer connected to their fathers. They are no longer connected to their leaders. Ladies and gentlemen, your hands are important in the equation of success. We are spiritual leaders. We are your backup spiritually. We are on the knees praying. But if we stay on the knees and our hands are down, why? Because the weight of the rod, it was the same weight when he carried it. But the more the weight stays on the same hands, the hands will become weak. Things were easy yesterday, but now in this situation, your pastor needs you more than anything. Support them with your tithes. It is important that you pay your tithes. There are people, the devourer cannot even avoid your house. He cannot even miss your address. Whenever you get money, either something goes wrong, either your boss stands against you, your children get a problem. Why? The devourer has got access into your house. The systems of the spiritual realm are different from the physical. The world wins by toiling, the church wins by trusting. The world wins by toiling, but the church wins by trusting. The Bible says, and Aaron and Hur, number one, they brought a stone for Moses to sit, and two, they carried his hands. The Lord is instructing me to talk to Aaron and Hur. Joshua's are fighting in the battle. They are people in prayer. There are people that are dedicated to spend nights and days in the Bible. They are fighting powers of darkness, waging war with the spirit of death. Now those ones cannot go to work. Those ones, they are laboring spiritually, and the others that are working downwards, they are laboring in businesses, they are doing everything. But there are others like Moses. Moses is not supposed to go and soil his hands to get bread. He's not supposed to go and soil his hands to have a support for his children. God has connected your blessing to your Moses. He has connected your blessing and your breakthrough. Actually, the next check, paycheck, or the next victory of your life is connected to the unison, to the unity of your hands with your Moses. Moses. He has the rod. The battle is down. The Amalekites cannot touch him. He's above their dimension, but he's a representative. How many of you have forsaken your Moseses? How many of you are looking at your leaders? When it gets to criticism, you're the first to throw a stone. You're critical over everything. But when it comes to support, you turn a deaf ear. When it comes to support, you turn a blind eye. Ladies and gentlemen, silver and gold belong to God. I was reading about Job. I'll talk about Job when he spoke about in between two nakednesses. He says, naked came I and naked shall I depart. Now, between the two nakednesses is the ability to make, to become better, to become greater, and to win in the equation of life. But he talks about naked came I and naked shall I depart, meaning everything that I have united with me after being naked. And when I'm going, I will leave it behind. God caused the storm in one day. The billionaire, the blue-blooded aristocrat Job, within one day, he has lost camels, he has lost children, within 24 hours, he woke up rich, woke up after 24 hours very poor, everything gone, and now the health is under attack. He's squabbling and scratching himself with stones. The same Job. It takes 24 hours when the storm and the torrent of the enemy attacks you. Ladies and gentlemen, God determines when we are rich. The Bible says it is the blessing of God that makes rich, and to it he attaches no sorrow. Thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is him that gives you the power to make wealth. Whenever you carry the burden of your pastor, when you carry the burden of your father, when you support them, I'm not talking about just spiritual parents, but even the physical parents. You have a mother that is always praying for you. You have a father that is always pronouncing blessings over you. You need to unite your hands with theirs. You remember also in the Bible, when Elisha was about to die, as I close, the Bible says, and King Joash came and cried, my Lord, said, Father, the chariots are the horsemen of Israel. And Elisha on his deathbed, he tried to lean, he said, now come. He said, get a bow and an arrow. And Elisha laid his hands on the hands of the king. He said, open the east window, shoot. When he shot, he says, the victory over the Assyrians. Shoot again, shoot to the ground. He shot in the space, he shot on the ground, dominion, whenever he touches base. And he shot three times and gave up. Elisha prayed and said, you would have shot at least five times. You would have conquered five. Why? When the hands are united with you, stronger enemies will be oppressed. Why? Remember, your priest is your representative in God. And is the fighter of battles, is the confronter of spiritual battles. Sometimes people send text messages and prayer requests to their fathers, to their pastors, even to me, the church that I pastor. They only remember you when the child is sick. They remember you when the battle is fierce. But when the battle has been prevailed, they don't remember to come back with testimony. They involve men of God and women of God in the battle. They involve men of God when the lions are roaring. But when they catch the prey, they hide it away from them. Ladies and gentlemen, I was assigned by the Spirit of God to tell you the power of United. As I'm talking right now, somebody has to do something right now. Do it to your pastor. Call them. Say, Pastor, this is just for you. I'm sending you support. Support them financially. Support them morally. Encourage them. They are human. They fail like you fail. The difference is when you fail, they are there to carry you. And when they fail, you're there to stone them. They are human like you. They are flesh and blood. And the reason why you see their errors, they are in the spotlight. But you have errors that when you come into the spotlight, the spots will be brighter. Stop having the blame game. Moses is carrying the rod. Go and support him. Pray for him. If you cannot support him anyway, support them in prayer. Publish their books. Support their families. Back them up. Be there to encourage them. When they preach, just call them to say thank you. There are moments I've come to preach when I have to dry my tears in the car before I come online. There are moments I come to preach when I'm just dragging myself by the bombardments and the storms of realities. But then when you come on air, when you come on live, you have to project the word, because there's somebody on the verge of committing suicide. Now, anybody that is there every day to push you, you need to back them up. The power of united hands. The more they carried the hands of Moses, the more Joshua prevailed. And they prevailed against the enemies to the going down of the sun. Why? Because Aaron and Hur were carrying. They realized. Moses did not tell them to carry. They had a revelation. The Shunammite, Elisha doesn't go to the Shunammite to ask for food. But the Shunammite recognizes this man is a man of God. We should beseech him and beg him that he will come and dine with us. There is something you have that can sustain an Elisha of your generation. There is something you have that can back up that woman of God, that man of God that has labored to raise, that has labored in the COVID season. There are people that only now, because the churches were closed, they are only listening to, and it is good to listen to men of God and anointings. But then there is a covering above you. Because listen to me, when you follow anybody, you can be encouraged. But there is one that is discouraged when you're under attack. There is one that will not sleep when your children are under attack. There is one that will labor and pray when there's something wrong happening. There's a shepherd that will tear the lion asunder to deliver your life. David says, whenever a lion and a bear came to take the sheep, I would run by it and tear it asunder and deliver the sheep. There's one that can fight the bears and fight the lion for your behalf. Don't allow their hands to go down. Support them. Run to your account. Download something. Send it to them. Call them. Call them in the afternoon. When you have the victory, say, Pastor, I'm just sending you this token. Just go and enjoy your life. Pastor, this is not a tithe. I'm just giving you. I'm blessed by you. I'm lucky to have you. Why? The more the hands are up, the more, because the lifting of hands is a sign of victory. When men are victorious, they raise up their hands. I want to encourage you to call upon every Aaron and Hur. You are the Aaron. You are the Hur. And listen to me. Aaron will never have a chance to be a servant of God if Moses is not a stammerer. Now, if Moses was like a god, God told Moses, I've made you a god before Pharaoh. I've made you a god before Pharaoh. I've made you a god before Pharaoh, but Aaron shall be a prophet. And Moses said, now, God, I'm a stammerer. He says, now, I know you're a stammerer. I made the stammerer and I made the perfect, but I called you the way you are. That means the imperfection of Moses is the qualification of Aaron. Because if Moses can talk, what would Aaron do? If Moses was not a stammerer, Aaron doesn't have a chance to serve. He doesn't have a position in the house. The stammering of Moses is the connection of Aaron. The privilege for Aaron to be a priest was because of what Moses was lacking in. Discover what is lacking in your father's life. That could be your ministry. And because Moses is carrying the rod, minus Aaron discovering that this man needs support. If the hands were not laid on Moses, they were going to strike Israel on the mountain. Remember, Moses is on the mountain, Aaron and Hur on the mountain, Joshua is in the valley, but they are prevailing against them simply because of one thing lacking. And many church members have circumvented it. We don't want to support our fathers. There are people that are too rigid, that even paying tithes is a rigor to them. There are people that are too, listen to me, when the world is marketing what they do, look at the worldly artists, they hire stadiums. They have a backup and a support. But look at the church. When we are doing events of churches globally, apart from those first class people that have really hit a certain dimension and tore the layer apart, when it gets to church things, people don't have money. When it gets to the worldly things, people have money. Ladies and gentlemen, your money comes from God. What a blessing for you to share what he has given you with his servants, and you'll be blessed. I want to say God bless you. Now, in case you're following and you're a backslider, or you have never accepted Jesus to be your Lord and personal Savior, I want you to touch your chest and speak these words after me. Say, dear Jesus, I have heard your word. Forgive my sins. Come into my heart. Write my names in your eternal book of life. From today, I belong to you. I am born again. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Finally, after what you've heard, put it into practice. Call those men of God. Call the Moses in your life. Do something. This is the season. It's the ripe season. God is demanding that. I believe that you've been blessed. If the message has been a blessing to you, share with others and others. Sami Okasanga, your name. Catch you sometime tomorrow. I love you. Bless you.
declare this morning, this afternoon, Lord, that all the praise, all the thanks, the riches, the wisdom, the dominion, it belongs to you alone.